My guest today, Laura Wright, has closed a whopping $43 million and then some over the past 20 years in sales. And she's the founder of Epic at Sales because, honey, she is epic at sales. And you are about to learn firsthand from the boss, the genius herself. And here's the really cool part. Laura has literally rebuilt herself from ground zero, from nothing. She had a seven-figure real estate company that crashed and burned in 2008. So she found herself over $500,000 in debt while also being the sole provider of her family. So there she was, lost, demoralized, doubting her abilities. She rose up from the ashes and she created her second successful company that she runs today, which is Epic at Sales, where she has really coined a name for herself in the coaching industry as the go-to sales ninja for service-based women in business. Laura's approach to creating wealth and scaling business is simple, effective, strategic, and she's just a beautiful soul. And I'm so excited for you to meet her today, to learn from her. This woman has a wealth of knowledge, literally a wealth of knowledge to share with you today. So get ready to meet Laura Wright. Laura, I am so excited to have you on the show today, and I'm so excited about this topic because it's something that we have not covered on the show yet, and as you may know, around 70% of my audience is female, and I know that women especially, you know, we can struggle in the sales process, and I think that, you know, your everything that you teach women to do is going to be super valuable for my audience to hear. So first and foremost, I would love for you to kind of share if you can think of like what really inspired you to get into this space of supporting women in sales. Like what really inspired you to get in this space?
I love this. Okay, so number one, I believe that smart, powerful women who make money change the world. And I believe that women especially, not anti-man, but pro like women, we tend to invest in things that enrich our entire communities. I know for me, my personal mission is to help women make money, master sales. And I don't just do that through my clients. I also empower women to make money by hiring women. And I know that they then hire other women and hire and hire all the things.
Ripple effect. So
it truly is. I even like to joke that we've made our own economy with my own clients and my people around me, because we buy from each other. So my mission is to help women understand how to master sales. Also understand that you don't have to do it in a hardcore masculine sleazy technique way. It actually doesn't work very well that way. It works so much better when you are connected. And I have to say, I was raised by a feminist who we're not anti-man. We're just absolutely pro-woman. And I think also when I noticed like there's statistics out there that only like 1% of the top 1% of CEOs are women. And I want it to change. I want it to become that all women are CEOs if that's their destiny.
Girl, it is changing. We're headed there. We are headed there. And like we are rising together. It's happening. I just had Sarah Pendrick. She was the last episode. I don't know if you know Sarah, but she's also movement, all with women, women empowering women. That's her movement. So I love it. We're on the same page for sure. And I also love like there's just the timeliness of this topic as well, because, you know, you and I spoke just about this before we hit that record button, but right now, yeah, people are starting to, you know, I'm sure many women listening right now, I'm sure you felt like uncertainty or felt a little disempowered or fearful about this, you know, current situation with COVID-19. In reality, there's a ton of opportunity for you here, sister.
Absolutely.
And especially if you are one of my girlfriends, Amber Valdez, always says light worker. If you're a light worker, meaning that you're supporting others through coaching or some teaching modality that really supports people to rise, this is the perfect opportunity for you to rise, to shine your light brighter than ever before, because right now people need it. People need your work. People need your light.
100%.
So I'd love for you to speak to that, because I know you started talking about this current situation and kind of tying that in.
Yeah. Okay. So here's what's really important about what's going on right now is we have a perceived uncertainty. And what I really want everyone to get is that it's the perceived uncertainty. It is no more or less certain than it was a week ago, 2 weeks ago, 2 years ago. We just get to like look back and connect dots and we think, oh, I knew what I was doing back then. The coolest thing about being an entrepreneur is like we're built for times like this. I was joking with my husband and some of my clients that like I've been living in the uncertain world since 2001 when I stopped having a corporate job in all the positive ways. So what I want everyone to really also understand about sales and why it's so important to be selling now more than ever. And I know everyone's using that phrase. It's getting a little worn out, but now more than ever is because you have to think about this for a second. Have you ever had like a girlfriend that you gave some like really great advice to? You talked, she asked, you told her what to do, and then she floated off and did something different or didn't do what you asked. Mm-hmm. This is what happens when you give free advice, that actual, the energy exchange doesn't happen. So the other person doesn't take it in and take action on it. When you do sales with service, when those two things are combined, I'm like putting my hands together here if you can't see it, because you're listening. What happens is the person actually gets the ability to take action from what you gave them and they will take it seriously. So selling right now is the piece that gives the transformation. So when you can sell now, you are stable, you are solid, you are serving. I want everyone to like really, we disconnect mm-hmm. sales and service and we think that it's what like you sell to somebody. Selling is the moment of transformation. It's the moment of service. I have had almost every one of my clients come to me at this time and say something to the effect of, Laura, thank God you made me an offer. Thank goodness I said yes to it, because they are thriving. And I think that will be something fun for us to talk about.
Girl, so, okay, I love that you said that. Have you read the book, The Go-Giver?
Yes.
Okay. Yes. Those of you listening, if you have not read that, or watching, by the way, this is going to go in video form too. If you have not read The Go-Giver, read it. By the way, it's a really easy read, super easy read. Also, it's like you're watching a movie. So it's one of those reads where you just like, you're sucked into it. It's hard to put it down. And really the premise behind, of course, as it says in the title is, giving. And I've shifted, like I read Go-Giver the first time, I think it was like 4 or 5 years ago. And I've been on a journey myself with shifting the way that I look at selling. I look at it as giving. Like, listen to what Laura just said. Like, Laura said that her clients were thanking her. What do you do when you receive a gift from someone? People think that's what happens, and you're giving a gift. So who are you to hoard these gifts, to hoard your gifts, to hoard their gifts from themselves? Like, you're hoarding your own gifts if you're not selling. So start thinking about it that way. Start thinking about it as, hey, I'm actually giving a gift to this person or these people. So I love that shift there. It's so subtle, but it's powerful.
Mm-hmm. And I have to tell you, there's a thing that happens on every single one of my sales calls, and I teach this. And then when somebody's on the sales call with me, they're like, oh my God, it's happening. I get to the end of the conversation and I collect the credit card on the phone and they thank me. I literally hear, thank you, Laura. After I'm collecting their credit card, they are paying me. But truly, it is a moment of thankfulness because I've helped them cross the bridge from, I don't know how to get what I want. And I'm showing them that together our work is going to get them out of their struggles into their vision. I will be their bridge. And that is a thankful moment because they get to step up and have what they want. And I always share this when I'm on a sales conversation, I always think of two women. They stay in my heart and I'm not going to cry as I tell this because I sometimes do. But I think of the one woman who I see her online all the time. She came to me and she was just not willing to say yes to herself. And I want you to hear that. Like, it's not saying yes to buying my stuff. It's saying yes to her higher self. And I didn't hold her. I didn't not force or push, but I didn't guide her across her resistance. I didn't do it very well. And she went off into the ether. And I watch her. I watch her join everyone's free groups. She reaches out to me every once in a while. And she's in the same struggle space. And I think about the women who've said yes. And the one that I think about the most is the gal who came to me insanely determined. I didn't actually know how dire her situation was. And it was dire. And years later, she actually told me how working together saved her life. And again, I did not realize what her dire was, but she said yes, because I held her belief and vision so strong for her. And we managed to go, she had made $22,000 in our whole year. We made $27,000 for her in 4 weeks. And she now, 2.5 years later, has a $350,000 business and is thriving. And I think about her every time I have someone on a call who's like, I want this thing, but maybe I'm afraid to say yes. And I help them see how they can say yes for themselves.
You're standing for them. That's another way to look at it. especially if you're getting resistance on the other end, think of it as you're not standing, you're not pushing them. You're not, so that's right. No. How many times have you heard that, Laura, right? Like, I don't want to be too pushy. Mm-hmm. It's not about being pushy. It's about standing for what you see possible for them. It's about standing for their vision. It's not about your vision. It's not about you. And if you're making it about you, you've lost the point completely. So I think that that's so powerful, because what you just said is huge. It's if you can just remember that it ain't about you, it's about their vision. How powerfully can you stand for them? Could you imagine? Look at what the difference that Laura just made for that client that she chose. And I'm sure it wasn't easy. I'm sure you had rackets coming up of like, am I being too pushy? Am I, you know, are they not going to like me? You know, that those would be my rackets, but you stood anyways, because you care so much, and they felt that. They felt that from you. And because you were saying yes to their vision, it inspired a yes in themselves.
Absolutely.
So freaking beautiful. Thank you for sharing that. That's powerful. I love
it. That's what I love to do. I just want to see, like, I see potential in my clients and the who I work with. Like, I work with multi six and seven figure business owners who have what I like to call critical need businesses. And I think this matches your audience as well. We've gotten into this weird, funky place where we're like, what is like the most critical thing? And people forget what they do changes people's lives. And I don't mean in like a broad strokes way. I mean, I work with women who help marketing firms. I work with people who do copywriting. I work with people who help branding and coaching and consulting and healing, like even hands-on and hands-off healing. These are the things that are actually needed in this world. I don't work with women who are like, I think I might sell like some lollipops, and like nobody needs lollipops. But they need our services. So I really want for women to understand how to articulate what you do so that the people around you know how to buy from you, because we have services that are actually critical and needed. And if you can articulate that so that someone understands how to buy from you, the crossing across the threshold becomes very simple, because it really is just, I have a solution for you. Here's what your vision is that you want. And the work we're going to do together is going to get you there. And it becomes a no-brainer yes.
I love it. Okay. Let's get into it then. Are you ready? I'm ready.
Ready.
Are you guys ready? Okay. Seriously, get out your pens and your notepads. I always remind you guys to do this, but right now, Laura is going to break down five strategies to selling. And I'm really excited about this. I think you guys really are going to get a ton of value from it. So get ready. Okay, Laura, let's dive in. Let's do it.
Okay. So here's what I do to help my clients sell out their offers and their programs. So the very first thing is your energy, your mindset, and how you feel about your offers. So anytime someone comes to me and something's off, I ask them to tell me what they're selling. And what I'm listening for is like, when, do you know those moments when you like can't wait to sell something because you're like, oh my God, this is going to help everyone. I got to get it out there.
Yes.
Yeah, you're energized. That is very client compelling. Mm-hmm. What I like to do is make sure that all of my clients have offers that they are in love with. Like, I have moments where I will help one of my clients articulate their offers and I'm like, damn, I want to buy that thing. I'm like, if you feel that energy that you want to buy what you're selling, that's going to convey. So number one, love your offers.
And can I say one thing on that? Cause that's really key, ladies. And the way you guys know, I'm all about magnetic confidence. That's the name of my book, confidence, right? That's a key, is you being so confident in your offer, and that's showing up in your energy. And I love that you said being in love with the offer. It's like, this is a good way to put it. Well, I'm kind of a movie person, and I love Netflix and I love movies. I don't know about you, Laura. And I don't know about you listening, but so when I watch a movie that like I really want my mom or one of my friends to watch, I get so excited because I'm so excited for them to experience what I experienced or what I know that they're going to experience, right? Like anything, like I watched some spoof video yesterday and I really wanted my friend to watch it. I was like, you have to watch this, right? Like, it's so good. And you're excited, and then it gets them excited and they want to watch it, right? And that all comes from that core belief, which is what Laura's touching on, is like believing in your offer. I mean, if you wouldn't invest in your own offer, how can you expect someone else to? Right? So it starts with you and you are source. So I just want to really hit that home because that is the foundation of it all. And I'm so happy that was your first step. So Keep going, sister. I love
it. I'm just
going
to keep clapping the whole time. We're like, we're having this great moment.
We're cheering each other on over here.
I do that a lot. I will get really excited and then I'll clap for myself. And I'm like,
I know it's like a really cute, for those of you who can't see, it's like a really cute golf clap too. It's like this princess golf clap that she does. It's like, oh, oh, hello.
Oh, this is so much fun. And ladies, this is how it should be. Like, think about it. It is compelling when, I like to say the highest energy wins. And that means that, like, when you are feeling excited about stuff, you can mess up what you say, but people are going to feel compelled because of how you feel. So love your offers. The second thing that I do with all of my clients to help them make sure that what they've got is going to sell is pre-selling it. I know this sounds like really simple and very basic, but what I do is before we build out all the structures, you get your idea, you get excited about it, and I have them go find a handful of people and they sell it to them pre-selling before they put it out to the whole rest of the world. And what this does is it gives you proof of concept. It also can help you fine-tune things. I've done stuff before where I've been like, this is the thing that I want to sell. And I have two colleagues who I adore who run multi-7-figure businesses, and I'll reach out to them and I'll be like, can I tell you about an offer? And they'll say yes. And I'll describe it. And if both of them would buy it, I then go put it out into the world. So I highly recommend that you pre-sell, either having a conversation with somebody that you know, love, and trust who can say, yep, this is awesome and is your ideal client, or goes directly to the source and start to pre-sell before you open up the doors and amplify with marketing.
Edifying your offer. I love it. That's so true. And also I'm going to like add something too, is when you go and, so this is actually more of a question. When you're doing the pre-selling, are you actually going to, for example, coach those people that you're pre-selling to, or is it more just see if they would buy it? Are you actually following through on the delivery there?
That is a great question. Yep. You follow all the way through.
Okay.
So cool. One of the five steps I'm going to talk to you about is actually the sales conversation, because I believe every single conversation is actually a sales conversation. And
I agree.
Every single thing, every time you're talking with somebody, I'm listening. Is this my ideal client? Do they have a struggle that I serve? Do they have a vision that I'm ready for? And if I do, and it feels good, it's very easy for me to open the doorway to sell, because I don't believe sales is something you do to somebody. Sales is a doorway of opening to explore and create transformation. And if there's an opportunity that feels good, you go forward. And if there's not, you don't.
Mm-hmm. Yes. And I actually say, and I learned this from Ascension Leadership Academy. You guys hear me talk about this all the time, but it's a life is an enrollment game. So you're either enrolling or you're being enrolled. Yeah. Every situation. So that's absolutely true. Okay. So what I was going to say about there's a golf clap. the queen golf clap. So there was one thing. So when you are doing your pre-selling and you start to work with those, let's say, you know, subset of maybe it's 5-6 clients, whatever it may be, make sure that you, at the end of it, ask for testimonials for two reasons. One, this is going to be gold for you when you start to doubt yourself and your offer. So you like watch those and you'll feel lit up, because then you'll remember, oh my gosh, like look at the impact that this is, that my product, my service has made with this person. Yes. It'll remind you when you forget, because Laura mentioned earlier, sometimes you forget, right? And you got to stay connected. So that's a really great way to hear it directly from someone you've worked with. And secondly, of course, for the content, like this is going to be key when you start really building out pages, you start building out your personal brand, you know, it's really great to have that social proof and those testimonials. So make sure that you ask for that from those pre-sale buyers. So I just want to throw that in there.
I love it. I love it. I just clapped again.
I love it.
Beautiful. Okay. So here's the other thing I like to do for my clients. And this, so you have to understand with sales and almost everything we do, it's about your, not just your energy, but like your strain, stress, and how your brain works. And here's what I know. When you are not sure what to do to complete something, it will keep you from doing it. So the next thing that I do for all my clients that helps them like always hit their ground running, hit all their sales goals, is we get multiple ways to reach the goal. Now, I know this sounds very simple again, but I want everyone to actually get all these things line up together, and that's what gets you success. So with every single one of my clients, we sit down and we find 3, 4, 5, 10, 20 ways that they are going to sell their offer in order for it to hit their goal that they want. It's a different number for each person. And sometimes people don't even need to do all 10 that we list out, because they might do one or two and it works and they have filled their program. Maybe they do need to do all of them, but basically what happens is your nervous system settles down when you know there's more than enough to get what you need. And that's what we're looking to do, more than enough ways to get what you need. So when this is one of my favorite things. This is what creates the fastest results with my clients. We sit down and we figure out 10 or so ways for them to hit their goal. We look at all the people they've already activated, ways that they're going to actively market, if they're going to do outreach, any of those components. We line them up and they just get to sit down, relax, and go through them. And they always hit their goals.
So question, when you say ways, this is like different product offerings, different packaging of, can you clarify that?
Yeah, please? Let me clarify. Definitely. So the short answer is no, it's more about like different, they're going to sell the same offer to different groupings of people or different people. I'll give you an example. So like one is one of my gals just, she sold this little tiny program. It's like $9.97 for like 6 weeks. And she had a bunch of people who had bought that. And then on her Instagram, she just did this live coaching call where everyone could show up and get lots of love and support. And then she went and did some outreach to past clients. Those are three.
Got it. Okay.
Ways and groups. Totally got it. She is going to now make her mastermind offer to, and guess what? They're buying by the droves. So what I like to do is have people see all the different ways. And Pia, sometimes it is a little mini sale. So one thing I love to do to sell my programs is also like my Epic Sales On Demand sales course, which is you buy the course, you get it right away. And I do like a little free workshop that goes with it as a bonus. So it's a really small price point, but it's more like a marketing offer. So when people come in and buy it, they get a little taste of working with me. And then I make a secondary offer to that group. And that actually gives me two ways to fill a program versus just one.
Kind of like a webinar.
Exactly. Yep.
Got it. Yeah, that's really powerful. I love that, because then you have all different. So yeah, I was thinking it as like, I was like 10 different offers, but I got it. It's more different ways that you can sell it into different types of people, different groups of people. Got it. Mm-hmm. I love that. And brainstorming that out probably is going to feel really good too, actually, once you have that list. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It lets you see what's possible.
Yeah, that's awesome. I love that idea. Okay. So that was step three, right?
That's three. Fourth one. So this is the fourth one. This one is the thing that makes it go from yes or no. Because remember when you're just asking, like, is it different offers? So why my clients hit goals, I'm going to tell you a little story. So years back, I had my Epic Sales On Demand course and we were selling it for like $9.97. And I had a goal to sell about a little more than $100,000. So we put it out, did a little marketing plan and all the things. And I had 35 people buy it, but I made $136,000. And I want you to like think about that math for a minute. So how did 35 people buying a $997, which would make $35,000, become so much more? And here's how it did. I recommend that you always have three offers that you're selling at any given time. And so what we do is, instead of people saying yes or no to working with me, I am maybe promoting one offer and they see it. But if we get on a sales call, I have three ways to work together and they get to buy one. So during that enrollment period, I knew there were going to be a handful of people who bought this who would probably want some extensive support. So I created just like a little like 4 month, like I think it was like an $8,000 thing that went along with it. So a lot of people who bought the course then also bought that. I also had a space to work with me privately. So while I was doing all of this enrollment period stuff or launches, as you like to call it, I was available to take on a one-on-one client and someone showed up and wanted to work with me. All those things combined makes it so every time I put out offers, I always hit my income goal regardless of the number of people who buy from me.
That's powerful. I love that. So having three offers, three different types of ways that people can work with you. I look at sometimes as also a ladder. Like if you have a ladder, a journey, a customer journey, because I have one client right now I'm thinking of mine that's actually like on that track perfectly right now, where it's like I had like a lower tier program, right? And then she went into my next one, and then my private coaching would be the highest. So I think having three different price points, like three different levels, if you will.
Exactly.
Yes.
Yep. Yeah.
And that's awesome.
What I love too is I recommend my three levels are not just the stair stack, like go up from different things price point wise. I also like to make sure that they are goal matched. And here's what I mean. So like the top one is the like VIP way to work with me. It's either faster, bigger, longer, all the things that somebody might want. And we do a lot together. And then my mid-tier is the way that I work with almost everyone. It's usually like we're going through like 6 to 9 months together. We do like three major things, stuff like that. And then my small bite, instead of my small bite being like by my course little piece, what it is actually about is just doing one thing. Like when we focus just on one thing and they get one result, then they're ready to step into another program where we're doing multiple things versus me doing like, if you're just starting, start here and go here and go here. And that's been like a game changer for me. It helps me deliver, it helps my clients, and it's an easier sale.
I love that. That's really, really great. So those of you listening, if you're really feeling inspired right now, you can either pause this episode, do it after the episode, like write that down. What, you know, what would those three things be for you? And that's exciting. I think that's a very powerful way to structure your business.
And it makes it so much easier. Again, it's not yes or no to work with me. It's which way do you like to be supported? Yes. Are you the VIP who wants all this gloriousness? Mm-hmm. Do you want to go on a long-term journey with me? Do you just want to get in, get out, get the thing and get going? And that just makes it like the person is empowered when they're buying. And what's really fun is I'll teach this in the fifth one, which is the sales process, is how to make you be in charge of the sales container so that you can determine what is high and low. When we start to talk about money, it's important to understand like what people will perceive as a higher price point or a lower price point. And you get to be more in charge of that when you have three offers.
Yes. And what's powerful about that fourth step too, is I feel like you're really able to meet them where they're at, which can create a sense of trust right away with that person because they feel seen, they feel understood, and they feel like you're meeting them where they're at. And they're probably going to be at that point more receptive and open to hearing the rest.
Yeah. So I have to tell you, so one of my current clients, I have a program that's Empire. It's a $100,000 program. And the way that the person stepped into working with me was she bought a little $497 workshop. And what she needed was she knew about me from her colleagues. She understood who I was. She watched all my stuff online. But you know, there's a difference between like, are you real or are you just the person that you are online? And she needed to have an experience of buying and trusting from me. And she bought this little workshop. It was a group thing. I helped her tweak one little offer. She immediately had a sales call after our workshop and sold a 12K pay in full person. And she messaged me back and was like, well, shit, Laura, if we were able to do that like that, I want to know what it's like if we work together for 12 months. And I was like, come on in. So I want for everyone to understand that it's not about when you sell the small bite things that maybe that is all that someone's going to do or need with you. But a lot of times it's just like what you said, Ashley, it's that thing of needing trust, and not just trust in you, but trust in themselves.
Can totally be a stepping stone. I love that. Awesome. Okay. Let's get into the fifth juicy step. Here we go.
I know. This is the one that makes me, and I keep forgetting. I forgot to ask if I'm allowed to curse. Am I allowed to curse on this? I'm pretty
good. Yes, this is, we're totally lenient podcast, right guys?
I always get to those moments where I forget to ask and then I put myself in bad situations. So
you do you, boo.
Thank you. I shall. Okay. We're
I shall. Let me think about that.
I shall. So what I find is I like to make my women unfuckwithable. And that's what I have for myself. Nothing can shake me. Like right now, you know, we talked about COVID just a little bit at the beginning of our call. And I know there's a lot of people out there who are feeling funky. And I went through 9/11 working in the events industry. And I was supposed to do a live event on October 11th with ExxonMobil. And like, they literally couldn't put people on planes. And they canceled that. The company that I was working for went under, like all the destruction. And from that, I decided to put myself back in command. And I built this real estate investment empire. It was a multi-7-figure business. And then 2008 happened and the real estate bubble burst. And I lost everything, and not just lost, but like massive debt. And from that place, I decided to rebuild in a way that could never be torn apart. And what I chose to rebuild on was my skills. So I've always been great at sales. I'm one of those natural salespeople, I get it. And I doubled down on what was it that I was doing that was working. So I refined my processes. I learned more from others, and knowing how to master the sales conversation, I'm in great shape. All of my clients are in great shape. I can go out and sell anything to anyone at any time because of this skill. So what my fifth step is to master sales. And the way that I teach it is I have a five steps to yes. And I'm going to tell everyone what five steps are right this minute, because I want you to use them and go sell. So first step is connection. And the way that humans connect, you will love this, is when we know, like, and trust somebody. And how we create instantaneous know, like, and trust. Do you know what humans know, like, and trust the best? Ourselves. So during the connection process, what I'm actually trying to do is show how we are the same. Like, I love that you have your pink headphones. Mine are downstairs. They're silver on the inside and pink on the outside. And my son stole them, but doesn't like them because they're pink. So then I have a silver pair that's just silver. So, like, I'm showing how you and I have something in common. And this happens to also be true. So during connection, show how the two of you have something in common. The next thing is we go to step two, which is listen and learn. And I call it listen and learn, but what are we listening for and learning? The person's struggles. We want to find, this is the arc of the
pain points.
Bingo. I ask, what are you struggling with? Why are you struggling with it? Why do you need to change it now? And those three questions let me know if a person's going to buy or not. Because if a person doesn't need to change it now, if they're not clear on their struggle, they will not buy. So we make sure we know that.
And even asking too, a question I ask is, how long have you been struggling with that for? Because that is, a lot of people don't, they don't ever, who thinks about that question? You just don't think, you're just going your day-to-day life. But if they think, oh, and whenever I ask that question, I literally hear them stop and they're like, oh, well, I guess. And then sure enough, it's like, well, since college, really. Wow, that's a long time. And then they see, wow, that is a long time. And then they start to realize that's unacceptable. So anyways, I love that. Keep going. You're on fire.
This is like the moment that I'm like, this is it. This is it. This, ladies, this is how you sell. It should also feel like this. So P.S., like what we're doing right now, where we're just feeling high vibe and enjoying our conversations, that's how sales should flow. So when you found out their struggle, what I like to always do also is I insert a little success story here from one of my clients. And what I'm trying to do is I'm showing the person that they're not alone. Because again, humans think we are the only one that struggles with this.
So true.
And so when you can show them, you become an expert. This also means, I want everyone to hear this loud and clear. Do not do free coaching or strategy on your sales calls. Sales calls are sales calls. If you choose to do free coaching or free strategy, I recommend that you don't, because it doesn't help people, and no judgment. But on a sales call, instead of you having to prove your coaching skills or your consulting like wherewithal, simply insert a success story that helps that person understand that you've worked with other people who've had that exact struggle and you got them out of it. Third step, I want to tell you, ladies, this is what people are buying. The third step is their vision. So once we figured out what their struggle is, most people immediately want to give them an offer. Like, you told me what was wrong. Here it is. I'll fix it for you. Instead of doing that, segue and ask them, well, what would you like? What does your vision look like? And if sometimes you can't connect to it, I ask them, how do they want to feel? What would an ideal day look like? Sometimes I tell them to walk me through your next 6 months. What do you want to create? Any of those words that help them talk about what they desire. And then we go to the fourth step. And I want to use a word very intentionally. The fourth step is the invitation. Now, most people say pitching or sales, and I don't like that because you, like, I don't know baseball very well. I'm not a sports person, obviously. But like pitching is throwing at somebody. That doesn't feel very good to me. So I like to give invitations. And sometimes I'll insert another little success story after their vision, explaining once more again, I know somebody who wants just what you want, and I've helped them get there. And then I just ask a simple question. Do you want to know how I work with my clients? And at that point, they do. When you can guide someone through their struggle and tell them you've helped other people with their struggle, when you guide them to their vision and you say, I know how to get you to your vision, do you want to know how? They're going to say yes. And then in that invitation, I'm giving them those three offers. And then this is where it becomes gold. So what I do is when I give my offers out and I describe how I work with women or how I work with business owners, is I like to explain and insert their struggle and their vision into my programs. This is what's powerful about a sales conversation. So like When you go to a sales page, a well masterful copywriter, yourself or the person who writes it, they need to speak to everyone. They need to talk to people who are instant buyers, people talk to logic buyers, all the different ways. And they need to get everything on a sales page. But when you're talking with someone on a sales call, you have a unique position where you can literally insert, they just told you what their struggle was.
Everything.
So when you describe it, you just say their
you're
words.
Literally repeating it back to them. And it also makes them feel seen and heard. And like you literally see them and you hear them. And that right there is gold. You don't need to invent anything. They already gave you the answer.
Bingo. And what you just said about feeling seen and heard, I can't tell you how many of my people are like, well, are you psychic? Like, I'm like, no, I'm literally, I'm like,
you just listen. You listen. You ask and you listen.
I'm repeating back to you what you told me. And that feeling of feeling seen and heard, I want to circle back to the beginning of our conversation about sales and service. There's transformation in the sales call. Whether a person buys or does not buy, they can receive transformation simply by being seen and heard. So when you give those invitations, give them the three ways you work together. Insert their struggle, insert their vision. I'm not a fan of doing like, you have to buy this one way because this is the one for you. And I will say one thing. If someone comes to me and they're in like a feast and famine cycle and they want to buy like a VIP day with me, I know that's not the tool that will get them out of feast and famine because they don't need more plans. They actually need long-term consistent support. So I'm listening. If somebody says they want something that I know won't get them their result, I'll circle back and ask them again. But then here's the other game changer. When I describe my three offers, I don't speak the price point. I simply describe who they're for, what they're going to get, and how they're going to get it. And I ask the person to choose the one that feels right for them. Once they've made that choice, it actually is the one that they know will support them. Then I ask if they want to talk through the dollars and cents. And we go right back through and I reiterate the offers, inserting the price points. And then we go to step five. So I do realize this is a little mind game. We just did five steps in five ways. And I'm telling you a five-step sales process. I don't go past five. But this is the number one step that I find women skip. And this is the heartbreaking step when you skip it, because it's very simply closing the sale. So we connected with them. We listen and learn for their struggles. We talk down their vision. We give them an invitation to work. And then we close the sale. The close is one of three things. It's either, yes, I'm in, and you collect that credit card on the phone. And ladies, if you want to know how to do it, I teach that because it's very easy and very important. Another outcome that is positive to a sale, and I think you'll catch this too, Ashley, is no. No, it's not a fit. And I have to tell you, there have been people in this world that I have gone through a sales conversation. They have said yes. And I'm like, oh no, they weren't.
Yep, same.
Just energy drain same. For them, for you, it's not good. So a no is a positive thing. The other third outcome is I need more information. And if someone needs more information or an objection arises, that's where I insert overcoming objections and walking through resistance. This is not pull someone over the threshold. This is not beat them down and make them buy. This is, if you're afraid, why don't we explore it? Like, why don't we see what is actually showing up for you? And you go through that close, but here's the other part that makes all the stuff work. When you do all five pieces that I just talked about and you have a repeatable sales process, you can guarantee your results. Like, I know this. I know if I follow my five steps on every single sales call, I know exactly what my outcome is gonna be. If I talk to 10 people, well, high probability if I talk to 10 people, I'm gonna have 9 or 10 sales. But let's just even say I only have 3. It'd be great because I would know if I wanna put 6 people in the program, I'm just gonna chill out, talk to 20 people, follow my repeatable process, and I know at the end of that, I will get my 6 sales. So ladies, I really want to encourage you to use a repeatable process, because what usually happens is we get on calls, and Ashley, I know you're just like me. I get on the call and you are magnetic, compelling, and excited, and you can talk and say anything and people are like, yes, I want to buy. But then maybe you might have a day where you kind of feel a little down or you're tired and you get on a call and you're like, you just kind of get through it and then people don't buy. When you use a repeatable process, your energy matters, but it's not the thing that is selling. It lets you have like a framework to kind of relax into, and you can know what result you're going to get. This takes all the strategy and all the magic and puts it together, and you hear yes.
Beautiful. Wow. What a way to break it down. I love these steps. I'm such an analyzer, So I love when there's like step by step, but this is a process that you guys can implement right away. And I hope you're excited to implement it because it's really great. I wanted to add two things. The first is, and this is like, I don't know if you do this, but with me, when you get someone on the call, like as soon as someone, you have them on the call, they say hello, do not say thank you. Because instead you want to say congratulations. Okay.
Yes.
Because you want to put them in that state of receiving because they're about to receive from you. They're about to receive a gift. Right. And it's something that I teach, my students, my clients is like when you are initially, as soon as they step in the call, they feel already like they've won. That's the goal. As soon as they've already gotten on that one-on-one call with you, this consultation call, you congratulate them. So like as soon as I'm on the call, I always say, congratulations for making it to the one-on-one interview process. Like I'm super excited. And they'll be like, oh, thank you. Like me too. And then they're saying thank you because they're in receive mode. Right.
Yes.
So that's a really great, just a little subtle thing, right? Just something subtle, but just again, everything matters because it's the state, the flow state that you want the whole conversation, them to be in, you to be in. And I forgot my second thing. So go figure. I just lost my second thing. It was something you were talking about closing and I'm like, dang it. And I'm like, I got to remember it. And I lost it. If I remember it, I will put it in the show notes for you guys.
Show notes it. And love what you're saying with the two other things too. So I do the same thing where when I show up on a sales call, I smile when I get started because remember people feel really, when they feel good, they feel good. So it's not, and I also want to say this, it's not artificial. Like I legit get myself into a high vibration that is me being at my best before I get on a sales call. So I'm there.
Yes. And you know what will help you get there, guys, is remembering your why. Your why is your fire underneath your desire. So if you remember your why, your mission, why you're doing what you do, why are you getting on this call? Why are you selling what you're selling? If you connect with your why, we just talked about this at the very beginning of the episode, being connected with your mission, with your why, with your purpose, with why you do what you do, because you know what you can cause and create, right? So when you remember that, that's an easy shift. Just sit down, meditate if you want, journal it out, whatever helps you. Dance, whatever, and get your body feeling your why. And then you'll step in and you'll be exceptionally more powerful than if you were not to remind yourself of that before. You should always do that before you step into any sales call, in my opinion. I remembered the final thing. So, typically the objection, if it's when you get to the money space, we all know like that you mentioned how much it is and then there's like this thing that happens, right? Sometimes. And then, okay. So here's the thing. They either don't see the value, right? So it's either a value thing or it's a price thing. A lot of times, like if it's a pricing and you can actually ask this, like I haven't done this. This is, I don't know if you know Ryan Blair, but Ryan Blair was talking about this at dinner the other night. And he was like, he's like, it's a value thing or it's a price thing. He goes, so you can ask them, are you saying that this isn't something you want to do because you don't see the value in it? That it's not worth this price, or is it sincerely because this price just won't work for you right now? It's not feasible for you, right? Because that right there is going to be feedback for you too. Because if they're not seeing the value in it, then there's some way you're not showing up, something that you're not creating for them, and right. So then it's kind of feedback on this process. Are you actually igniting their vision? Are you actually hearing their pain points and repeating things back to them? And speaking into their desires. So that final piece I wanted to throw in, and again, that's not something that I've personally done on the calls, but I know Ryan Blair is freaking, I mean, if you don't know him, you can look him up. He was on my podcast as well. And he said that, and I may be butchering it slightly, but that's absolutely true. And I think it's definitely either, if it's not a price, actual like price objection, it's typically a value objection. They don't see it.
And I love it. Okay. Can I give two more? Cause I'm like, oh shit, I just need to tell everybody everything. So one is one of the best ways to not hear the pullback with the money is actually inserting money into the conversation before you get to the invitation. So again, I teach that in my sales course to make sure you know when and where and how, but just knowing plugging in money saying numbers during the sales conversation will keep it so it's not like a jarring thing. Mm-hmm. And the other thing is when I, my little tip, techniques tips is I like to ask somebody, well, let's just say on a scale of 1 to 10, where are you? And if they say that they're like at a 6 or a 7 for making a yes, I'll ask them what would make it a 10. I think that matches what you're talking about with Ryan's question.
Yes, that's a good one.
They will literally tell you what they need in order to say yes. And then you can either solve that, answer it, address it, and then they'll be ready for their yes. So go to the
next. Write that down. Write that down, guys. That's really good. Where are you at in a scale from 1 to 10 in terms of like being ready to jump in? They, if they, whatever they give you, what would it take to get to a 10? That's because they will tell you, right? And let them know this is a safe space, like safe mm-hmm. container, just, you know, and that's really, really good. You know, it's funny because I think he actually said that too, over dinner. So yeah, I love it. I love it. And, cool. But honestly, I'm like, girl, there's so much like, I know we totally could. And there's already been so much value in here. I'm like, I have to shut myself up now because we're like nearing the end of the podcast episode, which flew by. Anybody else flew by. So Laura, this is amazing. Thank you so much for bringing this content to the pod. Like this was very much needed. And I just honestly would love to hear from you guys listening. If this is valuable to you, screenshot it, share it on social media, tag Laura and I, let us know what really resonated with you. We'd love to hear from you and interact with you as well. So Laura, how can people reach out? How can they contact you? Where do they stalk you? Fill us in.
Come stalk me everywhere. So first and foremost, I'm actually super duper accessible. I've had some people who are like, Laura, I was afraid to reach out to you because they usually know that once we talk, we're going to go work together. So what I want you to know is relax. I'm very accessible. Come find me on Facebook. Just type in Laura Wright. I also have a free Facebook group, My Epic Income Rise. Very easy to get to. But the most important thing that I want you to do is I want you to grab my book. So my book is nowomandown.com/book, and it's free. It's one of those things where I'm always like never, never free. And this is the one thing that is my mission. This is my 51 laws to create an epic income rise. This is what I wrote after 2008 when I lost everything in my multi 7-figure real estate empire. And it just evaporated overnight and left me with massive debt. I recreated who I was and how I showed up. And this is little actionable vignettes, little laws. We call them laws because I'm law, L-A-W, my initials, that can help you at any time go out and create a shift and a change. Their mindset, their sales, their motivation, and their little actionable steps. Go grab it. My mission is that there's no woman out there who doesn't know how to sell and create what she wants in her life.
That's beautiful. Okay. I will put that. That's in the description. So you can just go check the description. The link will be there for you guys. What an awesome gift. Thank you, Laura. You're amazing. And thank you so, so much for coming on the show today. I've really, really enjoyed our conversation.
Me too.
Bye.